Hello everyone, my name is Martin Lee. I'm currently a postdoc working in the field of 2D materials, and I'm starting this series, An Introduction to 2D Materials, as a way to help new researchers in the field get started as efficiently as possible. I am by no means an expert, and I also feel that I have a lot to learn still, so I'm using this as an opportunity to help you get started and hopefully learn something myself along the way. If there are any misinformation, please let me know and I'll do my best to correct it. In the first episode, I'm discussing the basics of exfoliation and transfer methods. For those of you who are not aware, the field of 2D materials started in the University of Manchester in 2004 and 2005, when Sirs Konstantin Novoselov and Andrei Geim started experimenting with the mechanical exfoliation of graphite into its monolayer form, graphene, by using a normal piece of tape. In my opinion, one of the reasons why the field of 2D materials was able to really take off is due to the simplicity and universality of the mechanical exfoliation method, which not only allowed Sirs Novoselov and Geim to do their research, but also allowed many other groups to quickly reproduce their results. Let me explain. Even after 18 years, the leading method of reliably producing the highest quality 2D flake is still by mechanical exfoliation from a bulk crystal. And this is nice because in principle, all you need is the bulk crystal and some scotch tape, and you can get started on your research. In other words, the barrier is really low for scientists to get started in this field. You don't need a lot of fancy equipment. The materials are not super expensive and don't require multi-million dollar machines to produce. For example, molecular beam epitaxy or pulse laser deposition are very cool experimental techniques to produce single crystalline samples, but the initial cost to set up those capabilities take millions of dollars and a lot of resources like cooling water and lots of electricity and ultra-high vacuum, resulting in a rather high barrier for underfunded groups or institutions to get started in. In comparison, 2D materials can naturally be found in large quantities in the ground and are said to be even higher in quality than the ones made in labs. And they are cheap. For example, what you see here is a massive mine in Quebec, Canada, where they are digging up large chunks of high-quality graphite. In the same province, high-quality MOS2 crystals can be mined. These are relatively cheap, under $100, and can last the entire duration of a PhD student. So, in this video, I'm going to give you an overview of the various exfoliation and transfer methods that are available in the field. I made a list of useful exfoliation and transfer techniques and shared it on my website so you can take a look there, but most of those will be explained in this video. By no means is this an exhaustive list. For example, liquid phase exfoliation, or the transfer of CVD-grown 2D materials, are elephants in the room which should be discussed, but for the sake of the length of the video, we will leave those beasts for another day. Many of the techniques you see here today can actually be used for the transfer of CVD graphene as well, so you can definitely try that out if you're in that field. Also, this list was last updated in 2021, because I actually made this entire presentation for the 2D Journal Club, which I used to organize in TU Delft back in 2021. So there may be a new method or several new methods that are not listed in this talk, but nonetheless, I think that with this information, a new undergrad or a grad student getting into the field of 2D materials can quickly get started. So I hope this helps. Without further ado, let's begin. When you're new to a field, it's often a good idea to start with one or a set of review articles. Here are the review articles you can start from regarding the exfoliation and transfer methods, but there are probably plenty more. If you look through these, you will quickly notice that there are a lot of information that are overlapping between them. So if you read a couple of these, you will already have a broad understanding of the exfoliation and transfer methods in this field. Before we dive into the details, I will tell you about the ways the devices are typically made. In the beginning, before the deterministic pickup and assembly methods were invented, 2D devices were made wherever the flakes were exfoliated on. In this process, a silicon-silicon dioxide wafer was pre-patterned with alignment markers and diced into smaller dies. Then, using tape, 2D materials were exfoliated directly onto the chips with alignment markers. Using optical microscopy, viable flakes were then identified and their positions with respect to the alignment markers recorded. Then the image was imported into a CAD or layout software with the alignment marks and the position of the flakes referenced with respect to the markers. Electrodes were drawn within the software. Then the design file was uploaded to the lithography tool, be it e-beam lithography or laser writer tool. The sample, spin coated with an optical resist or an e-beam resist, is then exposed using appropriate methods. And then after the process, the sample is made into a device which can be characterized electronically or optically. Nowadays, the process has changed quite a bit. Now, we separate the wafers where we do the exfoliation and the wafers where we do the fabrication of the devices thanks to the van der Waals assembly techniques, which we will go over in the second half. In this process, we will start with at least two sets of wafers, one for the exfoliation and one for the fabrication. The wafer for exfoliation does not require any pre-patterning. Bare 285 nanometers or even 90 nanometer silicon-silicon dioxide can be used for this purpose. But keep in mind that if we use the 90 nanometer for the traditional method of fabricating the device on the area where we exfoliate, then you may win the battle in optical contrast, but may lose the war on yield, since 90 nanometer silicon dioxide are more prone to puncturing during wire bonding. The device wafer should be pre-patterned with markers at the very least and diced. After exfoliation, the flakes are assembled using van der Waals pickup techniques and finally released onto the device die. The illustration here shows how the assembly of an encapsulated graphene device is performed. First, the topmost layer of HBN is picked up using a polymer. Then using the top HBN, the graphene and the bottom HBN layers are picked up subsequently. Finally, the entire stack is released onto a pre-patterned chip, and using the markers as reference, the stack can be etched into a specific shape and or contacts can be made. Now, with this in mind, let's move on to the first part of the video, which is the exfoliation. I took the liberty to make this mind map and classified some of the well-known exfoliation methods into these four categories, which are taking the exfoliation tape directly to the silicon-silicon dioxide, taking the exfoliation tape to a polymer, using thin films of metal or dielectrics, and finally exfoliating non-2D materials. The first exfoliation method we'll explore is the OG of the exfoliation methods. This method was used by Sirs Geim and Novoselov to isolate the graphene sheets for the first time and dates back to the mid-1900s when scientists reported on making 2D flakes that were only several molecular layers thick. We use high-quality silicon-silicon dioxide of a certain thickness for several reasons. 1. Silicon wafers can be atomically flat. 2. Graphene silicon dioxide adhesion energy is surprisingly high as reported by the group of Scott Bunch. And 3. The thickness of 90 nanometers and 285 nanometers give large improvements in the optical contrast. The last point is actually very important because if you think about graphene, a single atomic layer of carbon, it has a low density of charge carriers, absorbs only 2% of light, and small volume for light to interact with. So even if you have a monolayer of graphene, you may not be able to see that it's there. For example, you see in this paper that the wavelength of light and the thickness of the oxide determines how much contrast you have, so much so that with a wrong combination, it becomes impossible to see the flakes. The color map below shows that 90 nanometer and 285 nanometer are the thicknesses in which the light in the visible range can have the highest contrast. The optical equation is quite easy to understand, so if you have different materials or substrates, as you will see later on, you can quickly find out what the thickness and wavelength of light are needed to maximize the contrast. The I here is intensity. R's are the comparison between the indices of refraction between neighboring layers. And phi's are the phases resulting from the thickness of the medium with respect to the wavelength of light. Then the contrast is defined as the difference in the intensity with and without graphene. As you can see on your right, the same technique can be used to distinguish monolayers of HBN, which is even more difficult than graphene to identify. And thanks to this paper, the standard wafers used in 2D labs is now 90 nanometers and 285 nanometers. Next method we'll be looking at is an adaptation of the original method. In this method, instead of directly using the silicon-silicon dioxide for exfoliation, they pre-treat the silicon-silicon dioxide with oxygen plasma and apply heat during the exfoliation process to improve the adhesion of the 2D material to the substrate. With these simple techniques, the yield of monolayer graphene and similar materials are improved significantly. The idea is that with oxygen plasma, you remove organic residues or water adsorbates from the surface of the silicon-silicon dioxide. Then by attaching the tape with graphene and heating it up, the gases in between the graphene and silicon dioxide are released through the interface. And finally, when the chip is cooled back down, the 2D flakes relax to the substrate and adhere to the surface, leaving large monolayers on the surface. The paper describes this with respect to the internal and external pressures, but I'm not quite sure if this is a hypothesis or it has been experimentally proven. On the side, I've listed the protocols I've used in Delft during my PhD to make monolayer graphene and thin HBN flakes. I'd like to mention that for best results, press as hard as possible before the hot plate procedure, but not after. Heating up the adhesive makes it more mobile, and pressing on the tape while hot can leave residues on top of the exfoliated flakes. Another thing is to peel away as slowly as possible. Some groups even make Arduino-based machines that peel away the tape controllably even over the course of, say, 1 hour to get the best yield of something like monolayer graphene or monolayer HBN. Given the amount of contents, I've decided to split this video into several parts, so make sure to watch the remainder of the presentation. Next time, we'll begin with exfoliation using polymer coatings.